Andrew Witt is a PhD candidate in the History of Art Department at University College London. His writing has appeared in Art Forum and Object, and is forthcoming in Oxford Art Journal. Andrew will be participating in this year's Terra Summer Residency. That's right. Back to you. I put back. And Andrew's paper is entitled Valences of Destruction, Allan, Sekula, and the Comic. I did it again. We're on our way. Perfect. Thank you.
Thank you, Alan, for inviting me to speak, and thank you all for coming on a Friday afternoon. I want to begin my talk today with a work never exhibited publicly. The work, Accident Prone, photographed by Allan Sekula in 1977, was prepared for the exhibition California Stories 2011 at the Christopher Grimes Gallery in Santa Monica, California, but withdrawn from the show at the last minute. But to this day, the reason for its withdrawal remains unclear to both Sekula's gallery as well as his widow, Sally Stein. An Accident Prone presents a grid of 12 photographs, 3 up and 4 across, of a collection of so-called work-related accidents. Now, Sekula's title, of course, reads as a playful joke. For on first viewing, none of these photographs appear as mere accidents. When viewed as a grid in sequence, we come to witness two bodies and a dog possessed by a living force. Now, at the outset, I want to pose the question, what are these so-called accidents? Now first, a drill bit is cranked downwards pressing towards the pedal. Next, the dog is brought up as a sacrifice to some after that, a kneecap is threatened with a small hammer and clamp. Jumper cables are placed on a man's beard. Following this, a woman is shielded by a black industrial curtain. Later, an industrial fan appears to suck up the man's head. And subsequently, the same industrial fan appears to swallow his arm. Thereafter, a minute break clamp crushes down on the photographer's head. And preceding this, shards of fiberglass are threatened as a poisonous substance. And finally, an arm is measured against the circular blade, as if it were a 2x4. Now, figured within what looks like a community college workshop, each body, in all their exaggerated movements, lurch and teeter, stagger and stumble, as if sucked into a magnetic field of self-destruction. Now, in a sense, the machinic is figured here as a force of ruination, while each body appears possessed, perhaps, by a ludic death drive. Now, the protagonists in Accident Prone seem to cite the historic and clownish body of American slapstick. And yet, unlike the body of Chaplin, which will do anything to survive, Sekula's actors will do anything to destroy themselves. Violence migrates inward, to quote the words of Oscar Knight. Now, by 1975, Sekula had positioned his photographic practice, aesthetically and politically, against the work of his contemporaries, the new topographics, a type of work which he himself had admired, and yet whom he also described, half-jokingly, as the neutron bomb school of photography, a type of photography which, as he put it, killed people but left real estate standing. Now, Sekula had attended the University of California in San Diego with Rafael Rossler and Fred Landier, and graduated in 1974. Now, after his graduation, Sekula moved to New York and published 2 articles in the pages of Art Forum on the invention of photographic meaning, his MFA dissertation, and the instrumental image stuck in at war. The publication of these 2 articles came during the New York fiscal crisis of 1974-75. The same time Martha Russell would photograph the Bowery and 2 inadequate descriptive systems. Now, it was in January 1975 that Sekula would come to view the exhibition, The New Topographics, at the George Eastman House. Sekula's return to California that same year precipitated its aforementioned response, California Stories, a series of works conceived as the explicit model, counter-model, to the work of Robert Adams, Lewis Waltz, Stephen Shore, and others. Now, the entire series of California Stories includes Guns and Butter, El Toro, 1975, attempt to correlate social class with elevation above main Harbor Channel, San Pedro, 1975, Vietnamese Village, San Pedro, 1975, Cliffhanger, San Pedro, 1975, and Surf Movie, from 1973, and this is the shot in San Diego. And the two other works, Accident Prone, Sacramento, 1977, and Chinese Opera, San Diego, 1973, like I said, they were prepared for the exhibition in 2011, but were withdrawn at the last minute. Now, I want to argue that examining these works, unutilized at the time of production in the 1970s, is like the experience of viewing rarely opened, if not rarely examined, album of photographs. We look at these works not only for the first time, but also as a means to reevaluate our arguments about the work from this period. Now, if we were to compare these works against the larger arc of other projects enacted by Sekula in the early to late 70s, California Stories is situated between Sekula's earlier, more expensive photo works, which includes Aerospace Folktales, This Ain't China, a photo novel, and Performance Under Working Conditions, but also resembles the shorter, more performative works such as Meat Mass and Boxcar. This is Boxcar too. Now, building off his earlier work at UCSD, California Stories attempted to think through the relation of performance to photography as a means to address how social topography, in his words, could be read as a site of social strife, class war, land grabs, ethnic cleansing, race war, repression, and empire. Now, just quote Sekula further, this is especially true in California, where the bodies of the first inhabitants crunch underfoot with every step. Now, what I want to argue in this paper is the following. What is the comic in Sekula's early work is also that which is the most obstinate and self-destructive. And what I want to call satire is that which is at the same time unnerving, irrational, and aggressive. Now, we use the term comic specifically in contrast to other critical terms, such as humor or laughter, to link the term to the history of theater and performance, in particular, the work of Berkeley-based sociologist Irving Goffman. Now, in contrast to what Henri Lefebvre called the practice of everyday life, Irving Goffman argued for a dramaturgy of everyday life. Now, Goffman's work served as one of the central references to Sekula's own practice in the 1970s, as a means to think the ways through which everyday life was structured as a type of theater or performance. In particular, Goffman's The Presentation of Self in Everyday Life interrogated the ways through which social life is organized in the physical confines of a building, plant, or restaurant. Now here, Goffman emphasized a micro-sociological reading of social space through a front and backstage distinction. Now to quote Sekula Goffman's method, Goffman was quite removed from any Marxist paradigm of sociology, but much closer to the scale of photographic observation, end quote. Now, Sekula's This Ain't China, a photo novel, tested Goffman's sociological method for comic ends. This Ain't China reads today as a type of comedia about the work relations in a pizza restaurant and the organizing attempt to unionize. In one chapter, Sekula subjects the back region of the kitchen to the photographic micro-sociology. Now, in this sequence, the kitchen is subjected to a comical articulation of Muybridge-esque motion study. Now, in this particular chapter, the efficiency model of motion study is pared down, turned towards everyday working life, and interrupted by scenes where Sekula's protagonists are shown scratching themselves and making faces at the camera. Now, returning to Accident Prone, we can come to make another link with another unfinished work, the panel Chinese Opera, a work where the photographer and a group of his friends drift through a scrap metal yard. Now, in this sequence, cars are crushed and piled high, crumpled, twisted, and stacked above a crusted clay ground. One vehicle is upended as if it were a beach whale. The waste ground here is a bay of terrain, resembling something like an archaeological ruin, or perhaps something similar to a flea market, where discarded commodities pile up as if they were a type of accumulated wreckage. Now, unlike accident prone, it is unclear what opera Sekula's characters are performing. The question should be posed at the outset: what type of opera takes place in a scrap metal yard? Now, taking cue from accident prone and Chinese opera, I would like to read Sekula's photographs through a moving play of polarities between the comic and the obstinate, the comic and the self-destructive, the playful and the regressive. This is what I want to call the Valences of Destruction, a type of self-destructive humor where bodily images are displayed in their exaggerated form, thrown against the gears and technical apparatus of society. Now, in Frederick Jameson's Valences of the Dialectic, Jameson deploys the concept of valence to speak of the necessary reversals at work in any phenomenon, where the transformation of value and function may be said to constitute a changing of its valence, from positive to negative, from destruction to regeneration. The historical dynamic of destruction, I want to argue, is multivalent, one that moves from positive to negative and back. Now, in an earlier iteration during the past century, we saw this reversal explicitly at play, most notably in the work of Charlie Chaplin. Right in the work of Chaplin, Walter Benjamin argued that Chaplin's films were distinctly comic insofar as the laughter that they provoke hovers over an abyss of horror. Now, with Chaplin, horror and laughter are intimately entwined in a dialectical tension. Now, following a similar strand, Victor Shklovsky admired Chaplin's comedies in 1923, but in his article, he was perplexed by its comic content. Now, to quote, "I cannot at the moment define the essence of the comic nature of Chaplin's movements. But perhaps it lies in the fact that it is mechanical. You can divide Chaplin's acting into a series of passages, each passage usually ending with a full stop, a pose," end quote. Now, Chaplin's movements appear to accentuate the expression of obstinacy amidst the deadening forces of reification. The subject, in this sense, counters the violence of capital with comic obstinacy. Now, let us look at another work from California Stories, attempt to correlate social class with elevation above the main harbor channel, San Pedro, July 1975. Now, in this sequence, the artist's body and gestures are figured as a pivotal measurement of value. The sixth image compares three homes, hierarchically ordered, from top to bottom. Now, in three separate frames, Sekula's hand mimes the placement of the harbor channel in relation to an upper, middle, and lower class home. A class hierarchy is spatialized and made measurable to a body. With no other unit of measurement at hand, Sekula's body and camera stands in to assess the naturalized social order. Now, in each instance, the photographer's body serves as the primary, if not relative, unit of measurement. Now, notably, Sekula is rendered blind when he reaches the petite bourgeoisie and mute when confronted with a working class home. Now, in his essay on laughter, Homer Bergson asks a particularly important question applicable to these figures. Bergson queries, what is comic physiognomy? Now, if we were to think the piece in relation to other works of the time, such as Sekula's untitled side slide sequence, the photographs of police officers in Red Squad in 1973, this is it right here, Fred Lanadier's 29 arrests, or Martha Wash's vital statistics of a citizen simply obtained, there seems to be a continued reliance, if not an afterlife, of physiognomic thinking. To be more precise, the comic in Sekula's portrait practice should be read as an aesthetic strategy, a type of materialist physiognomy, a means through which the body of the artist, or more specifically the face, is deployed to demonstrate how social relations comically relate to political economy. Now, in the winter months of 1972, Sekula periodically stole fine cuts of meat from his local savory supermarket. Now, after the meat had thawed, the long-haired MFA student scampered down the on-ramp of the San Diego freeway below the UCSD campus and threw the tender pieces of steak under the wheels of oncoming traffic. The resulting photographs, neat mass, detail deadpan and comic transformation of the commodity form into a mutilated carcass. The traffic of bodies, in one sense, is disrupted by the traffic and theft of another body. Sekula's agency reads here as an unlawful agency. Now, in this sequence, we should see how the theft is figured obliquely. Before and after shots show stacks of meat on the supermarket shelves, and later Sekula exiting the Safeway supermarket, presumably with the meat in his jean jacket pocket. Now, in this sequence, Sekula's body is framed by the glass and metal door, as if, perhaps, the artist is like meat himself, on display, striking a congruence between the hunk of meat in his coat pocket, the object of performance, and the body of photography. Now, likewise, Sekula's getaway car is figured lengthwise and at an angle, so that the Safeway sign is clearly on display. Cut here to a shot of Sekula from the perspective of the overpass, standing on the side of the highway. Immediately in front of him, a big rig truck is about to rumble past, and thereafter, the sequence cuts to a shot of the freeway itself and a close-up of Sekula's hand, his own hand, holding this hunk of steak in a tense grip. The preceding action unfolds in the next six photographs. Sekula framed from the overpass, from the middle of the freeway, scampering to and fro, confronting traffic head-on, aiming and tossing the slabs of meat in the paths of cars. The third to last photograph shows the artist now crouching close to the pavement, grimacing. And next, the photograph shows the carcass itself, transformed into a white, bleached, fatty stain. And finally, the last photograph shows Sekula from the perspective of the freeway, scampering up the hill as if he were fleeing the scene. Now, as gonzo historian Rick Perlstein has noted, meat in the 1970s had a curious political content. In 1972, in the midst of economic recession and rising inflation, the price of meat was subjected to a national boycott over the doubling of meat prices. In Cleveland, Ohio, a judge was reported to have set bond at $3,000 for a man who was accused of stealing a 77 and a half pound sirloin from a restaurant. The judge had argued that the piece of meat was more precious than jewels. Now, for the title card of Sekula's Meat Mass, the artist wrote, "Meat Mass, interrupting the capitalist circulation of luxury goods through robbery." Now, I should note here that in such moments of crisis, it seems as though the most precious and the most abject enter into a mode of indistinction. We should recall that since the early 70s, Sekula's photographic practice was a project explicitly understood through what he called the disassembled movie, a matter of working photographically, which was conceived as a mode of editing and sequencing. Martha Rosler recently remarked that this was actually a type of exploded cinema. Now, to return to Meat Mass, the filmic methods of cinematic critique, mini-sequences, editing, focusing, panning, cross-cutting, is of course subject to assembly, montage, construction, but also including disassembly, ruination, and wreckage. On the one hand, the act of disassembly is positioned against the logic and structure of the factory. One thinks explicitly of the assembly line of factory production. But we should not forget either the disassembly lines of the slaughterhouse and the industrialized production of meat, the ways to which animals are boiled, stripped, and disassembled while still alive, and the ways to which Sekula's photographic practice disassembles the component parts of the photo performance, image, text, and sound. I want to flag here strong parallels between Sekula's method of the disassembled movie and Upton Sinclair's 1906 novel, The Jungle, a work which relays Sinclair's novel, the slaughterhouse appears to unfold perceptually to the reader disassembled. First, visually, there's the perception of darkness, death, and dirge. Then we smell rancid and pungent odors. Eventually, as we move closer to the curing beds, we come to hear a cacophony of perpetual explosions, breathless ejaculations of smoke, fire, and rumblings of a world in motion. Now, for Sinclair, the wonderful efficiency of the slaughterhouse and its rivers of blood, on the one hand, stands for the greatest aggregate of labor and capital in one place, and on the other hand, seems to condense all the dead things of the universe. Now, if we had time, we could draw direct lines between Sekula's Meat Mass with Frederick Weissman's harrowing documentary Meat from 1976, or Fassbinder's In a Year of 13 Moons from 1978. And recall also one primal scene of modernism, the Thai's dictionary for ducking moths, which places the abattoir and Eli Lotar's officially gruesome, if not banana, photographs of the Villette abattoir as the first entry. Now, on this note, I want to conclude with one passage from this ancient China, a chapter on his co-worker's dreams, dreams which were laden with meaning. Now, one passage recalls one dream where a female co-worker recalls having sex with the boss while his body was composed of raw pork sausage. Another dream described the scene of a morgue, where one alcove contained a series of glass vats in which horses' heads floated and were connected to oscilloscopes with platinum wires, while a slab of pastrami, as big as a man, was suspended on thin wires in an electrical field. Now, if there's a splinter of comedy here, it's a macabre comedy. And if it's a type of theater, it's a theater of cruelty. Now, some of us laugh when these relations are pushed to a limit in the work of Sekula. But if we do laugh, our laughter, in the words of Benjamin, hovers over an abyss of horror.